SESI, uma iniciativa da CNI, Confederação Nacional da Indústria, apresenta.
And if we want our students to be truly prepared for this world that they're going to engage in, this adult world, then we need to make them socially capital. That means they need to have the skills, the etiquette, and the abilities to engage in adults in a way that gets them success. How to have this professional look and engage with adults in a professional environment and look the part, number one. Then number two, to give them the skills to act the part. So we want them to be able to speak to adults in a way that they understand that they have knowledge, that they have preparation, that they're educated, and that they have skills that they bring to the table. And of course, for them to exude that confidence by having them engage with adults. There's this fine line or a balance that we have to bring into the table of innovation, where we're preparing our students for the reality of the different world that's out there, and having them be able to have the social capital to exist in both worlds confidently and comfortably.
Being in school inside of a library is pretty cool. It's considering the fact that it's like one of the only schools in the world that has done it, I feel like I'm a part of history.
It's different from a traditional school because, well, mostly the projects that we do and also where we are, because it's a pretty cool building that we have here.
Well, we only have four classes, four modules. Even though it's a longer thing, like a longer time in the class, but we have more classwork than homework. We do more stuff in class.
Enable us to do a lot that we're passionate about. So for instance, I'm very passionate about films and they gave me the opportunity to help along here and they allow us to get cameras and whatnot. So I really feel like that's one of the things that I like the most about the school, them enabling us to do those things.
The teaching method is kind of different, and I know with project-based learning, teachers have more freedom in how they teach the curriculum, but they still have standards on what they teach. And I like that because it gives them freedom, which gives us freedom to kind of express ourselves, but still get the curriculum done.
We are the only school that we know of in the nation to coexist inside a nine-story, $185 million library with more than 1.4 million resources. I think it's a novel concept. I think that's where all schools should be located, inside a library, because libraries and schools are a great synergy. It's like twin sisters. So our students have access not only to all of the resources that are on the shelves of the library, but they have access to the space in the library. And there are also services in the library. There's a homework center where students can go after school to get homework assistance. There's a maker space where our students actually intern and they work inside the library. So the synergy between the library and a school is one that I believe should be a model throughout the country, throughout the world, because it opens up so many possibilities for intergenerational learning, and they get the concept that lifelong learning is something that should happen for all students. Well, geographically, we are Center City. We're in the downtown East Village location in San Diego, with buildings, with high-rises, condos, commercial property, everything that makes San Diego, San Diego. The school is located in Center City because downtown is our classroom. We believe that the students should look at the challenges of our city because we have a component of civic leadership. What can they take from their learning in a school setting outside the school walls and make better because we're in the downtown location? The people that are moving downtown are the millennials. They're a different generation. They're very intelligent. They're innovative. They have a lot of the trends of where we're moving as, in terms of a society, and they want a high-quality education that will prepare them for a future that we really don't know exists yet. And we believe that's why E3 was chosen to be downtown San Diego.
You don't remember your harmony? Stay on the opening A. Here we go, from the beginning.
E3 Civic High is a public charter school that receives state funding. We also receive federal funding. So that means we have a lot more freedom and flexibility around curriculum, hiring, staffing, and of course our instructional model. Well, students are chosen by a lottery if our interests exceed our number of seats. And for the past 3 years, the number of seats have been exceeded by the interest.
Okay. So actually, this word is a combination of two words. This one means sun. This one means moon. When there's a sun.
So here at E3, we have students from different socioeconomic backgrounds, students who come from across the county. So we have students who bus in maybe an hour and a half from the east, from the border area. We are close to Mexico. And they come with different experiences, different resources or capital. That's financial capital, educational capital, social capital, and emotional capital. Because we know that students are at different levels, we also have after-school study hub, and we have a what we call a seventh period mod for kids who need additional support. So we meet them where they are, and we think about what are the resources that they need, and we provide them in a number of different ways to ensure that the core goals of E3 are met by every student.
Let's go ahead and start getting stuff for the lab, please. Okay, let's also grab lab coats.
Currently, we have 409 students enrolled this year, and the maximum capacity is 500. So we have four grades now. We've grown to a full complement of a full high school at grades 9 through 12. The students start at 8 a.m., and technically they leave at 3 p.m., but we actually open the doors at 7 a.m., and students can come in early for tutoring. So they come in and they start their first module as advisory. Then they move to a four-module day, and those modules are about 87 minutes. We have extended modules because we're a project-based environment. So that means math, history, English as humanities, science, as well as our performing arts, is merged throughout the day. So the content overlaps. So that means they can learn all of the content throughout the day with different teachers through the project link. Civic High prepares every student to leave us college ready, career ready, and a civic leader. So that means they've had a rigorous academic program that they can enter college without remediation. We want them to be able to enter and succeed if that's their choice. Also to give them enough career exploration and experience so that they're ready to step into an adult job and be a step above any student at their particular age so that they can compete in the career world because they've had internships, they've learned the soft skills that some college graduates don't have, and their goal is that they've had enough experience in the workplace so that an employer would would want to hire them because the training level is lower because they've had these experiences.
So on Thursday, we're going to have a Chapter 4 assessment. We're going to do a big quiz on that. Next week, we're still going to continue with trigonometry, which is why I just call it, you know, an assessment. It's more like a checkpoint, kind of benchmark, big quiz.
I am a senior at E3 Civic High. I've been here since it opened in 3 years ago. So I come from a Hispanic family, and education has always been super important. Education is important to me as well as to my parents because they sacrificed so much for me to get a better education than I would have in my native country of Guatemala.
Yeah. So all we're doing basically is just graphing the...
We're just finding the word in graphs.
Mm-hmm. From the words, exactly. These are just like trig word problems.
I came from a traditional public school, which basically had every single class in one time period, lunch, and then, you know, go home. So it was very basic. And then I came here looking for something different because I didn't want to stay in a school that was so standard, you know, was so, I don't want to say boring, but didn't really give me much to hope for. From my understanding, project-based learning would be the education one can receive during group work, doing a project. So mostly, instead of doing so many other assignments, like turning in papers, we will work on a big project together with other peers and learn what we need to do while accomplishing that project.
If we're using a cosine parent function, where should this maximum point be, the first maximum point?
On the y-axis.
On the y-axis. So we know it in a parent graph it would be here, so we need to figure out this distance that it moved, which would be our h. So what is our h?
Five.
Our h is 5. Rather than traditional teaching, which is just purely content. So say in a math classroom, maybe I'm teaching about right triangles. I just purely give the theorems. I purely give the content, have students practice problems. Project-based learning says that I'm going to teach through application. So instead of teaching the unit on right triangles where I'm just giving students practice problems with triangles, we're actually going and we're measuring different things. So we're really just using things in context and giving purpose to instruction.
All right. Open up the door. Thank you.
So the only rule we have for this, we have less than an hour, so I'm going to give you guys about maybe 40 minutes, 35, 40 minutes. That's the building we're measuring, right? So you need to find the distance from the base of the building to where you're measuring, right? That's the whole point of using tangent, yeah? All right. How about it, folks? If you have any questions, ask.
What we're doing right now, we're studying trigonometry. So we've done probably about, maybe about 10, 12 days in class of studying exploration of trigonometry, sine, cosine, and tangent, and its uses, as well as just straight doing the algorithm so that they can solve problems. So the culmination is a project that they need to come out and measure the height of this building. They had to decide how they were going to get their measurements. They had tape measures, meter sticks, strings, whatever they wanted to do.
What do you add this distance to?
To his height.
To his height, and then you get the total what?
The height.
Total height of the...
Done.
Nice.
So did you use both?
Yes.
And did you get the same measurement between that and your phone?
Yeah.
Okay. Exactly 60?
Or 59.
Okay. That's good. Yeah, the more measurements you take, probably the better, right? Just to make sure.
Since I've taught in a traditional school, I think the real reason why students don't like math, why they're so terrified, is because they don't see the relevance. They don't understand it. When things aren't given in context, if I just tell you A squared plus B squared equals C squared, you're not gonna know what the heck that means, and you're not going to know how to apply it. Right now in our classes, we're preparing a lot of content that the students are going to use to apply to their project. They're currently learning about different types of functions to use in their business plans. They actually know what they're doing and why they're doing it, which is why I feel, again, I hope that students like math here.
Okay. Hello, my name is Janice Mitchell.
Hi, my name is Armando Valdez.
And we are the owners of Sucre Cupcakes. I am the director of operations.
And I am the director of marketing.
Together, we both work on creating recipes for our restaurant.
The project that our seniors are working on is interdisciplinary. We are calling it the E3 Shark Tank Business Plan Project. It involves math and humanities. This project includes aspects of economics, government, math, and English, because the students are learning all four disciplines as they create business projects for the East Village community of San Diego.
Passionate about music, problems with accessibility and finding instruments and studio space. So if there was a place like this in the East Village, it would be like easy access to get all that.
Yes, we're gonna cut the prices so that people can afford studio time a lot easier, like $25 compared to the $100 or $200 that a lot of people pay for, you know?
Yeah, and then it would be like give us an advantage.
Students are creating a Kickstarter page where they are displaying everything that they have researched regarding their business project from the economic standpoint all the way to the artistic standpoint. So students have created a budget sheet. Students have also created a plan visually for their businesses. And every business plan is being worked on by a team of 4 to 5 students. That's something that we have worked with all disciplines on, but it's specific to my class right now.
Good morning. What are we working on? Career opportunities?
Huh?
What's our topic?
I'm doing religious freedom.
I'm doing equal pay.
Equal pay? And are we working on our
articles?
Your articles?
Yeah.
Okay.
We had to like research like 3 articles and then do summaries about them.
And then key points in the article.
Okay. And yours is equal pay?
Yeah, between the women's national team soccer and the men's national team.
Problem-based learning, we look for problems that exist locally or globally, and then collectively as a class, as a grade level, we look to ways that we can solve that. The use of problem-based learning was a core component of the school structure. And the board thought that problem-based learning would engage kids in ways that we don't normally see them engaged in schools.
What's your project on?
I'm doing Planned Parenthood.
Planned Parenthood?
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah.
That's a political hotbed.
Yeah. So I'm looking at the history. I think it should be like pro-choice,
mm-hmm.
personally, but you know, that's like a big debate on that.
There's a big debate. You look at the Republicans and the Democrats,
uh-huh.
right?
Yeah.
And the conservative.
Mm-hmm.
So the first year was very challenging because we were building the plane as the plane was flying. And so it was understanding the PBL model, problem-based learning model, understanding where we were, and then using where we were in the downtown area to also impact or influence the curriculum that was developed. Our kids generally come from the downtown area. We have a good number of students who are on free and reduced lunch. We had a good number of students who came in with grade point averages, which were quite low, courses to be made up. And so we had to think about, what do we do differently? So why were they not being successful in the last place? And then what do we do differently? So we knew that our curriculum had to be engaging. And if we were going to give the computers to our students, the question was, how did we do that in such a way that the students could care for the computers and take them home, bring them back, and use them in the way that we had intended? And so that first year, kids were challenging. But over that first summer, there was like a metamorphosis, an evolution, so to speak. So when they came back, they realized that they were in a great space. They realized that this was different than anything that they had experienced before, and that the use of technology now had empowered them to engage with the entire world.
You probably don't all get to choose your own individual usernames. That's the most fun part, right? But please make sure, when you're choosing your username, please, 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 absolutely, it should be school appropriate. That goes without saying, but just as a reminder.
So we utilize Google for Education, which is all the Google apps, so we incorporate that into pretty much everything we do with all of our lessons. Google Drive, Google Docs. We use Gmail. We have websites. We do blogs. We do Hangouts. So all of that that's incorporated with the Google apps. We also utilize the Adobe suite. So I kind of go in and I help teachers learn how to use any of the Photoshop, Illustrator, InDesign, show them how to incorporate that into their curriculum, how to properly research using technology, not just the books that we have in the library, but actually going online and doing proper research that way. What the students are talking about, what they enjoy about using technology in the classroom is that they can learn at any time, at any pace. So the teachers will sometimes use a flipped classroom where the students would be expected to look at the material at home and then come back in the next day and they would have their discussion. So the time in class wouldn't be taken up with the instruction. They can actually discuss what the content is.
Okay, so we're coming back to the pleasures of eating. But before we hop into that, I want us to look at this question. Or actually, it's not a question, it's a statement. So describe the behaviors of a political activist.
They go to the support, like Bernie Sanders. They go to their rallies.
Okay, what else?
The pedagogical benefits of having an interdisciplinary curriculum give kids deeper learning and to engage them in ways that we don't necessarily see. And so the interdisciplinary part gives us an opportunity to find use, to find value, to look at things from multiple perspectives. And the interdisciplinary project-based component ensures that we create and do good for the community. We have a homeless situation in our downtown area. And so that's something that we engage in terms of how do we find solutions for the issues that exist with our homeless. So we have the E3 way, which is to educate, to empower, and to engage. And we can't empower or engage unless we're educated. But the education should not just be about learning things, but how is it useful? And making use out of what we learn. When we think about our project-based learning and the interdisciplinary component, it is how do we then use the information to empower and to engage.
Well, how did you guys come into serving seniors?
I was homeless. And the people there did me well by making a phone call here and getting me situated where I can move into here. And I'm thankful for that.
We are trying to do is make a documentary of seniors and tell their story through the camera.
When you first got to serving seniors, what was your first impression on the place?
When I found out that they have activities here, that was it. This was where I wanted to go.
We did some work around mindset as well as in the first year, and we've continued to build upon that work. Carol Dwyer's work around hard work, grit, and perseverance being characteristics that they want to possess, that they want to build on, and to really create students who persevere, who really stick with the task, who when it gets tough, they keep on moving, and that we make these connections with them so that we can empower them to become these amazing learners, and then of course pass that on to their peers.
Okay.
I think that what you guys should do is, after you got the bathtub out, and I liked how you did like this thing, I think we should add like gossiping or doing your nails or doing your hair so you're not just standing there while David's singing. We need to work on spacing Horns and Who. Haley and Matt, or no, Max, it's Max's fault. I love your lines, you're great at your lines, but you're saying them at the wrong time. So, and then I blame Messina because I always blame Messina. So make sure that you get that song first, then lines.
What I've been liking the most is having access to do whatever you want. You can, if you don't like your classes or if there's something bothering you, you can easily go talk to your counselor and try and get it changed. If you want to make a club, there's easy access to make a club. There's easy access to talk to people or be with people that you're more comfortable with. It's just easy to sort of do things that would be a little bit tougher at traditional schools. Maybe getting your classes changed at a traditional school would be more challenging, but with this, I feel it's just more, it's easier to do.
So, summarizing. How do you guys summarize?
Ruth.
Oh, you could, you don't need to include the small details, just the main events.
No small details, I like that, yeah.
Advisory at E3 Civic High is very key. It was written into our charter as a place where the teachers would become facilitator, advisor, someone who brings all of their skills and knowledges to the table for their students. Advisors typically have between 15 and 17 students, and we have different lessons that are rolled out during advisory that help students become experts in how to explore colleges, how to pick a college, how to prepare for college, all of the assessments, financial aid, and everything that they need to become college ready when they leave. The career assessments are also rolled out through advisory, career exploration, guest speakers, job shadows are coordinated through the advisors, internships are coordinated through the advisors, and the advisors serve as that person down in the weeds with the student to make sure that they're not falling through the cracks.
If we change the angle to 60, the tan's gonna be 1.73, and if we multiply by 89, it's gonna be about 30 more.
And being that you were not accurate, but that's closer to accurate, what was that mistake you made? I hesitate to use the word mistake, but...
We were too close.
Not too close, because if you were too close, you'd have gotten 63. But what did you use as an angle?
Well, let's talk about personalization as it relates to academics. So we're really pushing now that students own their data. And they own their progress around reading, literacy, around their progress around writing, competence, and their progress around mathematics, and of course, learning the next-gen science standards as it relates to the science content. And what we're going to push out eventually when we're full scale is that students would have a dashboard using a platform called Illuminate, where they can track their progress and their data and their skills-based competency so that they'll actually understand what skills that they've become competent in. And we have an entire dashboard that has a display of this work. So not only the display of the work, but how it should happen in implementation is that students should be able to move at their own pace, particularly in math, because it's probably easiest there, when they're ready to move forward in skills that they can move forward because we're using technology to enable that work.
Now, when we talk about political candidates, we want to know their background. Are they a person of integrity? But do we know this about our food? Who has a food package?
I have one.
See, if you have food in your bag with a package, shake it up. All right, Jaime, what are you eating or not eating? What don't you know that you're putting in your body?
And the ingredients are corn, vegetable oil, which is the corn is canola and other sunflower oil, monosodium, glutamate, cheddar cheese, milk cheese, and artificial flavors.
What is glutamate?
That's a great question.
That is a great question.
Is it gluten?
Okay, welcome to biochemistry. Glutamate is a neurotransmitter. Who knows the role of neurotransmitters?
Transmit signals through your brain.
Right. The FDA, Food and Drug Administration, says, okay, it's okay, but in small amounts.
The humanities course is a study of literature and social sciences concurrently. So it's already an interdisciplinary course, which works really well for project-based learning because it's an interdisciplinary investigation. It's presenting an issue, a question, a concern for students. And so I have control as a teacher in terms of what content I expose them to in the history and social science side, and they're using that and saying, oh, wow, Mrs. Nicodemus
told us that it was really important to consider who the author was of a piece of literature. And so now when I'm reading this, I'm going to make that same decision to really think about what the author intents was.
But the question is, to eat these things and not know what they are, it is like putting someone in office and not knowing who they are. But what are the implications of that?
Heart attacks.
Yeah. Heart attacks.
One of the things I reiterate with students, just as a part of my practice, is that we're there to become stronger reader, thinkers, speakers, and writers. And that in doing that, that makes us stronger collaborators, and that all of that requires creativity. And I think one of the ways that I encourage students to see themselves as leaders is by asking them challenging questions. I think a number of students and people in general aren't leaders because they've never been asked to lead. They've never been challenged. And so I make a point of challenging students, and they realize that they can do it, and then they want to do it more, and then they become leaders in the sense that they begin to ask themselves and others challenging questions. And I think that's an important part of leadership, not always having the answers, but knowing which questions will keep leading you in the right direction.
What do you think is most different about the school?
I think that there are a lot of things, like the space is very unique, the size is very unique, especially I came from a middle school of like 1,700 kids. But I think how real world is integrated into the classroom is probably the biggest thing. A lot of my projects are based on my interests, the interests of my peers, and I think that that leads itself to really like positive discourse, but also like really authentic dialogue in the classroom. I grew up in a political household and I was always interested in politics, but my desire to actually become involved started at D3. I think the political conversations that happen in the classrooms as a byproduct of how a lot of our projects are about social issues, I think that I believe that politics are my way of kind of making a difference in the world. And I think that every student kind of finds their niche within the school and kind of politics and student government. And that's been really important to me.
Hi, your school says engage, educate, and empower. I would like to know more about the empower part, like how you as a student feel empowered and how the school has helped you with that.
I think that that empower to me was really important, especially the role that I played on campus and how that translates to the role I play in other aspects. So I work a lot in progressive politics and policy. I'm the president of the California High School Democrats, and I also work in national organizing with the High School Democrats of America. So I think that when we look at how do we empower ourselves to be our greater selves, I also look at how am I empowering myself to take on this role as a community leader.
So what font is that on the bottom?
This one?
Yeah.
Gotham.
So you can change it to the Gotham book and then change the logo size to be a little bit bigger and take out the Help Minds Grow so you can put that on the cover. Does that work?
Yeah, okay.
Okay. Sounds good. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Well, I know the benefits of internships is one is that it brings relevancy to the classroom. So students get to see that what I'm learning in the classroom matters, and it applies when I go out into the world of work. And also it applies to when I'm getting ready to go into my career. Second thing it does is help motivate students. It motivates them to know that not only their teachers, but people outside of this school want to work with them and motivate them, encourage them. And then it gives them opportunity to talk to adults that are in a career that they want to do, and they can ask questions that maybe we don't know because we haven't gone into that career path, but they're able to ask questions and get an idea of what to expect when they're getting ready to go into that career.
The school, it's in the library, so they had a lot of internships in the library, and I am really interested in history. So I thought, you know what, what's the better thing to do than special collections, you know? They got classic books, San Diego history, and I get to kind of indulge in all that stuff. So that's why I kind of chose it. The importance of this internship is that I kind of get a real life job experience, you know. I have coworkers, I get to work with my partners. I think it's a really good opportunity to get my foot in the door into the library too, so it's all around a great experience.
So in Command Eagles, that's the bass.
Where are the audio?
Audios, yeah, so there's a vocal.
We're a nonprofit organization in San Diego, and what we do is we use the power of media production to teach audio and video to homeless and at-risk youth. So we engage youth in the creative process. We use that to then bring mentorship into their life, to speak into their life, and to also teach them viable skills that they can use in the real world. The homeless population and just our regular students that come through the door, there's really, once they come in the door and they're engaged in the creative process with art, there's no difference between the students. They interact as peers. They don't necessarily know each other's situations, but all that they're focused on is creating art. And it's beautiful. A lot of the times the kids are side by side at school. They don't know each other's situations, or maybe they do, but when it comes to the studio and art, it's all about creation and productivity. Art is our way for us to connect. Media production is a way for us to connect, and everybody's on the same playing field.
We can look at each individual instrument. You got all the vocals you guys recorded, which sound fantastic, except for Kyle's. Find Kyle's.
I believe that the overall experience here at this internship is beyond amazing. I mean, we've learned skills that we'll be able to use and apply in our daily lives. I did mention time management, but not only that, but how to apply ourselves in different positions, like flexibility, that's very important here. And then learning how to work with co-work with people that you aren't familiar with. You're in a complete new environment, and that's something that we have definitely mastered here, and that's something that I'll take with me.
So in that scenario, does it make sense for this image to be grouped with that? Because that's how it's kind of looking, right? Okay. Mm-hmm. Cool. And then these are all perspective shots of the outdoor space?
The E-Block, the different electives, that was always the intent of E3, to create that environment. The first year, again, because we were just starting up, we weren't able to bring everything into play. This is our third year in existence. Getting the resources, getting our students acclimated to this environment took a bit of time. But the initial core goals of the charter were to ensure that we had the internships, that we had one-to-one technology, community college courses on campus, and to ensure that students had opportunities to take the Chinese and Spanish courses. So those things were in place from the very beginning, but resources and just building up to it over time, or having the time to build up to it, were necessary to get to where we are today.
What is our ultimate goal? What are we trying to make these robots do?
Pick up a can and
drop
it in the middle of a target.
Drop it in the middle of a target. But right now we're going to work on step three, just opening and closing the can. And we're going to use a servo to do that. So you all have your claws. Make an open position with the claw. Robotics is the E-Blocks course that I teach. So my robotics students are students who are generally interested in computers, technology, branches of engineering, things like that. And in my robotics class, the goal for the course of the year is for students to participate in a robotics challenge, a robotics competition somewhere in San Diego. I think the main importance is that students find what they're passionate about. That's something that me as a teacher, I really try to stress here with my students, is that whatever you're going to do, whatever it is, whatever interests you have, we want you to build on that. We want you to find things that you're excited about, that you're excited to learn about, and that you're excited to do every day.
A famous Native American quote says, "The great circle of life, the circle of unity, with all things in the universe, including the great spirit, our creator, above all which all life revolves. We are all equal in this circle. No one is in front of you and no one is behind you. No one is above you and no one is below you. We are all related." Hello everyone, my name is Rakaya Dorian Salmon, and I am here to ask you an important question. What does life mean to you?
In the communications class, students work together on developing speeches. They brainstorm, they collaborate, they discuss, and then they write their speeches, rehearse them, and present them. So it really helps students strengthen their verbal speaking skills, which are something that is so necessary for our work environment. The school does place an emphasis on digital media and the uses of technology, but within this class, students are presenting speeches, which is very different than just putting a PowerPoint together and turning it in. You know, getting up in front of your peers, even though you know them very well, having a articulate and well-devised delivery is a skill that not a lot of high school students encounter. So this is a more rigorous course for them at the college level.
Our assessments are like that of a normal school. I always say that E3, the style of project-based learning is a little bit different in that projects are used as a culmination of learning rather than maybe the strategy in which knowledge is acquired. But I think that like we have tests, we have quizzes, we have papers, and projects are, it really depends, but I want to say on average are about 20%, 15 to 20% of the total grade, but that includes kind of all of the standards that are leading up to the final project. But it's a part, but it isn't everything. Like you still have to do, you know, you have to do your work to do well.
Our school does have grades, and we do a reflection at the end of the project. So a student will complete a project, and then they'll have an opportunity with their group or individually with their teacher to discuss the things that they learned and more of those life lessons, those soft skill lessons that they would apply to their next project or life in general. But there is a grade, right? And so we grade on different things. The research paper, did you do in-text citations? Did you do your citation page properly? So there is opportunity for assessment in the traditional sense that most people are comfortable with. But there does come a time where it seems to get a bit of a gray area with regards to assessment when we move to the creative aspect of things. How do I assess a short film that a student creates? What's an A film versus a B or a C? So when the project shifts and has the creative portions of the assignment, the creative deliverables, that's when prior to you have to have conversations with students about what the expectations are. And it's tough because you could potentially have, you know, a rubric for a student doing a video speech, an infographic, and it just comes back to the teacher really needing to dedicate a lot of time and planning and work into how they are going to assess each of those pieces with the students before the creative deliverable starts. So the student knows what their aim or goal is, and they have a very clear idea of what the expectations are. Project-based learning is not easy work, but I really do believe it's more meaningful work.
So what we want to do is to make sure that when working with the kids, to understand it's about relationships. And I think that prove to students that you care and believe in them again and again and again. It's so important for them to understand just how we are and why we get into this business and what's the major role we're going to play in them when they're going forward.
Well, the first thing we do with our hiring is we, of course, do a panel interview to find out all the characteristics of the teacher in terms of interaction with adults. After that, then they do a demonstration lesson in front of the students and other faculty. And the students get to weigh in and share their voice, and the other faculty get to weigh in and share their voice on if they believe this would be a good fit for our team. Do they bring the tenets that we believe are important, such as collaboration, deep content knowledge, the ability to relate to students of a diverse background, to love all students and to accept them, to be self-reflective. And we take that information and then we make a hiring decision. Once we bring that staff on board, then we want to fully immerse them in training in August. So we bring our staff on board 10 days prior, where we engage in a series of trainings to bring them up to speed to the E3 way in terms of the expectations of faculty and staff.
Is there any way to get microwaves for the students in place? Because that's really kind of a bummer that they can't bring a lunch to warm up, not to cook, you know, because some of them it's like you cook it for 12 minutes, nothing like that, but just to heat up. Because I know Brendan's complaint has been that now that he's switched schedules, like his teacher that he had would let them out a few minutes early from their third mod, and so he would get to the lunch line and everything was good, but I guess he said that the line is so long, he says by the time they get up there, it's like there's nothing that you want left or something like that.
I think what happens is the students don't like to wait in line,
yeah.
But we actually time the line, and everybody's through in 12 minutes.
Really?
Yeah, really. You should come and watch.
Yeah.
Because then you'd see for yourself, because what kids sometimes do is they just don't like to get in the line.
Oh,
you tell mom, that line was so long. So they
yeah.
wait, they don't get in line, and then they get in line at 2 minutes before lunch is over.
Oh, I see.
And then there's a problem. Of course, there's no line at that point.
Yeah.
The Parent Support Workshop is a monthly group to meet with parents to determine with an adolescent going through high school, there are going to be a lot of changes. And sometimes if you're a parent, maybe having a child that when you were younger, thinking like, oh, these are the things that we're going to have to look out for. It's being on the forefront and informing the parents of what's actually happening with the students today. So just trying to be more of an informative meeting group for the parents to kind of at times not only find out more about what's happening with the kids today and what they're getting involved with, but at times just being a sounding board or just a environment where they can come and kind of talk to other parents to say, yes, I'm going through that too. Yes, it is difficult raising my child. Yes, it is difficult with all the demands that they're putting on the kid. But as we know, as they become more successful in life, that level of support is going to be imperative for the parents to be able to be there for them.
We decided that Anna was a non-conventional kind of student. We had experience before with her older sister in a traditional high school, and we felt that there were possibilities for something more that she could get out of school. So she was strong academically, and we were looking for a school that gave her academics, but also the chances to grow in different ways. When we placed Anna here, it was a little scary because it was a brand new school, so you never know exactly what is going to happen. So we had to kind of had a little bit of faith and let things move along till we found out that this school actually was offering Anna both academics and alternative ways to grow at a personal level and explore things in a different way.
What do you think about Seuss? 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 Seuss?
Think of an elephant up in a tree.
Think of a person too tiny to see.
The school is innovative because they allow the children to think outside the box. I found that my children have really grown since being here. It just challenges them to think on their own versus being told what to do. They challenge them to make changes. I just like the way that they allow the children to learn interactively with project learning, doing projects, learning how to communicate with other children.
Há muitas experiências que vêm buscando maneiras efetivamente novas de organizar a escola, né, essa instituição formada para ser um lugar de produção de conhecimento e não de reprodução do conhecimento. Então, as escolas passam a se organizar de uma forma mais parecida com o que é o mundo fora da escola. Os estudantes se organizam por interesse, em grupos, que vão desenvolver um projeto juntos ou vão estudar alguma coisa que interessa para eles. Vão, sobretudo, fazer uma intervenção na comunidade onde a escola está. A escola passa a ser um agente na comunidade importante, porque, se pensar, é uma instituição de produção de conhecimento, na maior parte dos lugares, a única, né? Não há universidades espalhadas por todos os lugares, mas há escolas, em muitos países como o Brasil, espalhadas por todos os lugares. Se a escola assume esse lugar, essa é a instituição de produção de conhecimento desta comunidade, ela tem uma ampla tarefa a fazer, que é conhecer aquele lugar, pensar como melhorar aquele lugar, quais são as questões sociais ali colocadas, e todo o currículo se organiza a partir daí. Então, aquela questão da falta de sentido que o jovem, a família, a comunidade vê em relação à escola, essa questão desaparece, né?
What I like the most of E3 would be how family-oriented and friendly it is, how I can talk to anyone in the staff. Now, when we started applying to colleges, they asked us, what do you need? We said, hey, we need college help. We need help with applications. So they brought in a couple counselors. So I really like that about E3, how helpful and friendly they've become.
All alone in your room, as you're facing your doom.
I think the most important thing I've learned here is teamwork and working together with other people, because to get through the school, you need to talk to your teachers a lot. You need to speak up. You need to be able to have your voice heard without being shy or backing away is the thing that I think is the most important I've learned here.
True speakers are organized in their delivery with an identifiable beginning, middle, and end that the audience can easily recognize and understand.
We learn how to learn. And for me, though, the big thing at E3 is I learned how to be a more critical thinker. And I think that that has served me professionally in terms of, like, navigating politics, like, extremely well. But just that ability to, you know, think really critically is definitely an E3 value that I learned.
Education is changing. It is inevitable because everyone is realizing, and we're having this common conversation around how do we prepare this generation and the ones to follow to rule the world, to make this world a better place, to transform it by personal success for every individual. And I'm excited about it.
Uma parceria SESI, uma iniciativa da CNI, Confederação Nacional da Indústria.